Professor A.R. Venkatachalapathy from the Madras Institute of Development Studies will speak on From Erode to Volga, Periyar E.D.R.'s European Travels 1932. On Monday, we have a special talk by Dr. Kama McLean from the University of New South Wales on the Congress and the Revolutionaries, Political Pressure and the 1929 Purna Swaraj Resolution. We have a public event at 5:30 on Monday the 14th. It's preceded by a tea, and you're welcome to the tea and also to the event. We are releasing the first volume of the selected works of C. Rajagopalachari. There are also talks as part of the function by Gopal Gandhi and Ramachandra Guha. On Tuesday, in the regular Tuesday seminar, we have Dr. Hari Sen of Ramjas College speaking on counting people, counting money. People were doing that even in the past. The Bhils in Mewad in the 19th century. And on the 17th of October, a subject which I'm sure is very topical, the making of the McMahon line and its fate, 1947, by Dr. V.C. Bhutani, formerly at the University of Delhi. And Friday next week, just to conclude, a very significant topical event from a different perspective, the Naga peace process moving towards the further settlement or further crisis. I assume there's a question mark after that. Professor Sajal Nag, Senior Fellow of the NMM. Very happy today to welcome Nandan Nilekani, who will be speaking in a public lecture, which is part of the India and the Wider World series. When we were devising this lecture, somebody asked why you're saying India and the Wider World. Isn't India part of the Wider World? Of course it is. But there are many institutions in Delhi where these issues are taken up, sometimes from a strategic point of view, sometimes from what one may call a narrow neoclassical economic point of view. We felt it would help to have a larger sense of history, a larger sense of perspective on the various ways in which India was, is, was not, should be, or should not be linked to the wider world. Ms. Nilekani needs no introduction, but just to say two things about him, which I'm sure are known to all of you. He is presently chairman of the Unique Identification Authority of India. He has worked in several capacities. He's one of the well-known alumni of the Indian Institute of Technology, the founding member of Infosys. One of the reasons we felt it would be a very good idea to request him to speak is because the larger question of technological transformation and the third industrial revolution is something at the back of our minds, but there are very few people who are both technically qualified, but have a larger sense of where we are at the present, would be willing to speak on this. So I'm especially happy, despite his incredibly punishing schedule, that he's here. He's beat the Delhi traffic and he's been here for a quarter of an hour. So I'm sure all of you are looking forward to what will be a very engaging lecture. Mr. Nilekani.
Thank you, Mahesh. It's really a great pleasure to be here in this extraordinary campus that you have here, historic place. The topic I chose for today's lecture was India and the Third Industrial Revolution. Now, there are many definitions of what was the Industrial Revolution and how many of them there were and all that. I will go by the definition of an economist called Robert Gordon, who's at the University of Northwestern University in the U.S. And basically he said that there are broadly three industrial revolutions. The first was between 1750 and 1830, which was the rise of steam engines, the rise of the locomotive, which led to the expansion of the railways, and the development of the telegraph, which became the first modern method of communication. So the first industrial revolution between 1750 and 1830, and these are all, I mean, different people have different definitions, I'm just going by his definition, consisted of telegraph, steam engine, and the railways. The second industrial revolution, in his opinion, was between 1870 and 1900, which, in his opinion, was the most dramatic industrial revolution, because that was the rise of electricity, and which led to lighting and all the other use of electricity. It led to the development of the internal combustion engine, Daimler, and then the expansion of that, the world's largest factory in Rouge, Michigan, by Henry Ford. Engines and cars again led to replacement of horse carriages, reduced pollution in cities, allowed people to live and work far away from the city, came up with the idea of suburbs, led to the interstate highway system and all that. So that's the second one, all the consequence of the industrial internal combustion engine, which also led to development of petroleum and petrol, gas, and those kind of hydrocarbons. The third thing which we often forget in the third very important dimension of this industrial revolution was essentially running water, plumbing, and heating. Now, heating is not an issue in India, But in cold societies, the fact that you have central heating improved your productivity because you could, you know, you could maintain temperatures throughout the year. And running water and plumbing essentially improved productivity because people didn't have to go far away like they do in India to find wood or to get water. And it improved sanitation. As you know, there's this whole debate about toilets and temples. So indoor plumbing was a very huge role in improving sanitation because you had clean drinking water, you didn't have sewage mixing with water and so forth. So that whole revolution of running water, indoor plumbing and heating. And then the other big thing that happened in that second industrial revolution was the rise of molecules, you know, the chemicals, plastics, pharmaceuticals, penicillin, the whole use of re-engineering of molecules to get all kinds of new products and things like that. And then finally you had the revolution of communications, the rise of the phonograph, the rise of the radio, the moving picture, which came, you know, more than 100 years back. So all these things happened together, and that is broadly called as the second industrial revolution. The third industrial revolution is really from 1960 onwards, and that is the all the stuff that we associate with computers. You know, the fact computers, internet, World Wide Web, you know, mobile phones, internet. All these things are the so-called third industrial revolution. Now, I will speak about this revolution specifically with respect to India because, you know, there's a whole thesis of what it has meant to the West and all that, and you can read Professor Gordon's paper on that. And my broad thesis is the following. I argue that the first industrial revolution actively worked against India, and it was part of, you know, British rule, and I'll explain why I think it was. And it's not an original idea. Many people have talked about how up till 1820, half the world's GDP was in India and China, and then Britain and all these countries had the industrial revolution, the terms of trade changed, and India and China went from 50% of world GDP to whatever, 15-20% of world GDP in 200 years. So we know the story of how the industrial revolution hurt India in the early part. So my argument is that the first industrial revolution essentially hurt India because of the terms of trade and because of the way it was used by British rule. The second industrial revolution essentially bypassed India in some sense because a lot of the fruits of that didn't apply to India, and I'll try to explain why I don't think it did. And I argue that the third industrial revolution, the rise of computers, software, internet, is actually a huge leverage for transforming India today. So in other words, the first industrial revolution, telegraph, steam engine, railways, hurt India. The second one of electricity, IT engines, running water, molecules, and communication, in some sense, we missed that one. And the third one of computers and the web and internet is actively, possibly, a huge strategic advantage, and I'll explain why I think so. Now, why do I argue that the first industrial revolution hurt India? And again, it's not an original argument. When you think about it, the entire change in the terms of trade between India and Britain was essentially because of the steel, you know, the textile mills of Lancashire, where India went from being a producer of textiles and garments to essentially exporting raw cotton, getting it processed in these mills and being shipped back to be purchased here. And that really happened because those mills came up with steam engine and other high energy multiplier, factories and all that. And suddenly the productivity of those ways of manufacturing fabric was much, much higher than, you know, hand loom and those kind of things. And so fundamentally, all the India, from being a great producer of its own fabric, muslin, all those things, went to becoming nothing but a raw material provider to the West, which in turn sold finished goods back to us and created jobs there. So clearly the whole, and if you look at the Angus Madison tables, which define how this changed, you know, up to about 1820, India and China were about half the world GDP. But 1820 onwards, as the UK and all these countries, the GDP growth went up and India and China stagnated, steadily over 200 years they went and became a much smaller part of the economy. So the rise of the steam engine led to the rise of textile mills, Lancashire, all that thing, and that led to economic terms of trade and India becoming a raw material producer. The second thing was the telegraph. The telegraph was invented somewhere in the early 19th century, and India was among the first countries to have a telegraph. And telegraph in India was in 1840, 1850, and thereabouts. And by And again, it was used by the British to essentially to run this large country. And by the year 1857, India already had 4,000 kilometers of telegraph. So all the major cities, you know, Calcutta, Delhi, Bombay, were all connected by telegraph. And a lot of people believe that in India's first war of independence in 1857, the fact that the British had the telegraph and the Indian, people fighting for independence did not, actually created an unequal playing field. Because the British could use the telegraph to tell where the agitations were, move troops around, warn a city that somebody is coming and all that. So fundamentally, when you think about it, the telegraph actually played a decisive role in the, again, some historians may argue with all this. I'm just putting a theory forward. I'm not a historian. I'm just a pop historian. So one could argue that the telegraph system in 1857 was a huge part in creating knowledge asymmetry between the British, who had access to this means of communication, and the Indian soldiers and troops, because they didn't have a way to communicate among themselves, whereas the British had a way to communicate among themselves, and therefore they got the upper hand in the 1857 war. So the second big invention of the first industrial revolution, the telegraph, also hurt India. And the third big invention of the first industrial revolution was the railways. Again, railways in India have been there only for two reasons prior to independence. One, for commerce, and the second, for security. What happened was, India became an exporter of cotton. I talked about that in the earlier thing. And they wanted a good way to transport the cotton to the port so that they could be shipped to the UK. And therefore, the first railway line in India was in 1853. Between Thana and Bombay. So the first railway line in Indian history. And then what happened was, in 1861, when the American Civil War broke out, the Americans stopped exporting cotton from the US to the UK. So suddenly India became a huge source of cotton, and therefore the big boom, you know, the whole Bombay boom and all that happened in 1861, 1865. And so fundamentally, that drove the formation of the first railways, which was in 1853, which later on was essentially for transporting cotton to the ports. And then, at the same time, after 1857, and this episode I talked about where the telegraph essentially created the, you know, advantage for the British also realized that unless they had a good system of moving troops around quickly in India, they could not dominate the country. And hence, the security reason of maintaining British dominance in India led them to rapidly build a railway network in India. So all the construction of the Indian railway actually began in 1858 or 1860. And by the year 1880, the British had laid 14,500 kilometers of railway lines. And fundamentally they did it because they said, we don't want another situation where, you know, the people will revolt against us. And therefore we must have the mechanism, or we need the infrastructure to navigate and move troops around in a big way, and that's why they went and built the railways. If you look at the whole, they built the railway lines and they built the railway cantonments and all that. So from nothing in 1852, they had 14,500 kilometers of railways by 1880. So one could argue that if you look at the, so essentially the railways was used either to dominate the rule of the country, or it was used to export Indian raw materials. So my thesis is that if you look at the three big sort of developments of the Industrial Revolution, the first one, the telegraph, the railways, and the steam engine or the steam machines built on steam, all three in some sense disadvantage India. So that's the first part. So let's come to what happened in the Second Industrial Revolution. The Second Industrial Revolution was remarkable because it really improved people's productivity. The moment you had running water, women didn't have to go long distances to get water. The moment you had electricity, students could study at night. The moment you had the automobile, you could travel you could stay anywhere and travel. The moment you had chemicals and pharmaceuticals, you had better drugs, your longevity went up. So everything that you look at in the Second Industrial Revolution dramatically helped in productivity and so on. But by and large, the bulk of that missed India. Because in India, in the time of the Industrial Revolution, which as I explained to you was somewhere between, as his definition is between 1870 to 1900, let's say the full deployment of that, we say 1930-1940, all under British rule. And the British really had no interest in propagating these things in India except for their own purposes. So if you look at the history of Indian cities, actually they built cantonments where they lived, or they built hill stations. India, in the British built 65 hill stations in India in the time they were, from Uti at Kunur to Kasauli at, you know, Masuri and all that. So fundamentally, they didn't build cities for the people, but build them for their own enclaves. And all the other things required mass infrastructure and mass urbanization. In the period of the second industrial revolution in the West, they went from 20% urbanization to 80% urbanization. So basically, people moved in large numbers from rural US and rural Europe into cities. They went from agricultural jobs to service, manufacturing, and then to service jobs. And because they had to build these cities, they could also build a network of infrastructure like plumbing and water supply and sewage and all that. So fundamentally, all of these things came together in that time. So while the second industrial revolution is playing out, India really didn't play in that one, and therefore, at the time of independence, India was only 15% urbanized. Even today, it's only about 30% urbanized. So it didn't really have a role in the urbanization or the building of the infrastructure. There was, you know, it may have been 20% at the top level. A few people had access to these things, but it didn't have the mass impact that the second industrial revolution had in the West. So my argument, as I said, first revolution actively hurt India's interests, the three things I talked about. The second industrial revolution, we had benefits. I mean, let's face it, the first power, you know, the first electric bulb was done by Edison in 1879, and the first bulb in India was in 1903, which is not a bad thing. Within 24 years of the first light bulb, the first bulb actually lit up in Bangalore, where the Maharaja of Mysore put a power plant in a hydroelectric power plant in Shivasamudram, because he wanted electric power to dig gold out of the Kola gold fields. And since Bangalore was on the way to Kola gold fields, they also put up a light in Bangalore. That's how the first bulb came to Bangalore. So we did have power maybe 24 years after Edison, but not really at the scale that power and all these things happened in the West. So by and large, we missed the second industrial revolution. Now, what is the third industrial revolution? The third industrial revolution is what we're seeing today, which is the rise of information and communication technology. And today, it has become ubiquitous. Now, to give you a brief history of that revolution, in some sense, the third industrial revolution of computers is linked to the second, because it all began with the electric bulb. In 1879, in Menlo Park, Thomas Alva Edison lit up the first bulb, and that was using this incandescent filament, and that became, you know, the first light bulb in the world. And using that same technology, in the 20th century, they came up with the concept of vacuum tubes. So vacuum tubes use the same concept of a bulb. The diode of a vacuum tube really uses the same technology of a light bulb. And therefore, the first large use of this technology in electronics were actually in radios, where they had, you know, radios were made with vacuum tubes. Some of you may still have some of those old vacuum tube radios. But the big advance was when these vacuum tubes were used to build the first set of computers. This again happened during the Second World War, when there's a huge need for cryptography and supply chain to build computers. So the first computer, the ENIAC, was built using vacuum tubes. So by about 1940s, they had figured out how to build. They were huge computers, because the vacuum tubes are big and all that, and they need a lot of power. So you had these computers occupied huge rooms. And then, because of the rise of the communication, sometime by 1948, the Bell Labs invented something called the transistor, which instead of having this big thing called a vacuum tube, did a small thing using some silicon or germanium. And the size of the transistor was 1/50th the size of the vacuum tube. So the transistor was the first step in sort of miniaturization. But the real rise of this computers and this small thing actually happened for another reason, because by 1957, the Russians put up the Sputnik rocket. You know, this was the height of the Cold War. And they put up the Sputnik in 1957, and that created the space race. And therefore, suddenly there was this huge need, you know, that led to the space program, Apollo 11, landing on the moon, all that. But fundamentally, what the space race did was, it forced you to come up with miniaturization of technology, because they could not make, you know, if you want to send a rocket, you can't make it very heavy. So they had to find a way of making the computing and all that in these rockets very small. So the computer and the transistor came together to miniaturize so that you could build all the sophisticated electronics inside a rocket. And that led to the rise of what is called as an integrated circuit, where they brought all the stuff together sometime in the late 50s. And then they improved that integrated circuit in the 1960s and put every bit of a computer into a chip, and that's what is called as a microprocessor. And even today, what you see are multiple generations of very powerful microprocessors. So by about 1960-68, we had the microprocessor. At the same time, as these computers started evolving, they had to find a way to connect all these things together. And it was very difficult to get these computers to talk. So finally, a guy called Wint Cerf and a couple of other guys, Wint was here last year, came up with the idea that let's come up with a way for computers to communicate even if they are dissimilar in nature. And that led to something which is about 30 years old, which is called the TCP/IP protocol, which allowed different computers to share packets. And it didn't matter whether the one computer was one brand and the other computer another brand. They had a common language to share information. So in some sense, the Internet began in 1983, which is about 30 years back. Then the Internet was still used by techies and defense guys and all kinds of funny things because nobody could understand what was going on. And then the big development happened in 1989 when the World Wide Web was created. And the World Wide Web was created actually in Switzerland by Tim Berners-Lee. And the purpose of the World Wide Web was he wanted a simple way for people to exchange documents. And that's how they came up with this concept of HTTP protocols, HTML, websites. The idea was that if you just have www.mmlindia.in or whatever your thing is, you just go to that website. You don't care where it is. You don't care where in the world it is. And therefore, the arrival of the World Wide Web made it far easier for people in the world to communicate, because you just had to keep popping on a link and you could go to any link in the planet. And that is further exemplified because by 1992, in the U.S. at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, they developed the first browser called Mosaic. So Mosaic was actually developed by a student at Urbana-Champaign called Mark Andreessen. And Mosaic, then that guy went to the West Coast, built Netscape, then Microsoft built Explorer, and the real Internet stuff began. And then, of course, after that, you had all the rise of the Internet companies, the Googles, the Facebooks, and all that. So this is how this stuff happened. Now, why is this revolution important for India? I will argue that it is important for a number of reasons. The first is, unlike the first two revolutions, this revolution is happening at a time when we are in full charge of our own destiny. Therefore, we are not really hampered by anything. That technology is something that we can access very easily. Second is that the nature of this technology and the competitive nature of the global economy means that all these technologies are readily available to you all the time. And therefore, it's so competitive, there's so much thing happening. Somebody in China is making some smartphone, all kinds of things are happening. So basically, nobody can really stop you from getting this technology. You have access to the world's best technology around the same time it is essentially developed. The third thing is that the cost of this technology is dropping every day. This is important to understand, because this again comes from a very profound insight by Gordon Moore, who was the founder of Intel in 1964, which said that computing power doubles every 2 years. Later it was reduced to 18 months. So every 18 months, computing power keeps doubling. And this has been going on from 1964 onwards. That's why they say that the amount of computing power in your smartphone is what was there in the first spaceship. So it shows how fast things are moving. So because of this dramatic improvement in computing power and reduction of price, computing is becoming very, very, very cheap. And therefore, today you can think of having unlimited storage somewhere on the cloud. You can think of having unlimited computing power. You can think of having unlimited memory. All these things are possible because of Moore's law. And this thing will only become cheaper, faster, better, more powerful in the coming years. The other thing which is happening concurrently is connectivity is becoming more and more ubiquitous. In other words, everybody is getting connected. And we have seen that in India. In India, 15 years back, we had maybe 50 million landlines and zero cell phones. Today, we have 50 million landlines and 700 million cell phones. And therefore, what we have seen is that we can really think of a world where everybody is connected. And, increasingly with fiber optics and LTE, 4G and all that, everybody will be on a broadband network. So we'll have broadband connectivity, which will become pretty universal. And then there is the rise of the devices. You know, the big shift in technology in the last 3-4 years has been moving away from PCs and more towards smartphones and tablets. And these are, you know, everybody has an iPad or a smartphone or Android phone or whatever. And these are very easy to use. They have very simple user interfaces. They have touch screens. You know, the whole thing has changed. Now, so even people earlier who were technologically challenged are now very comfortable using all these new devices. So suddenly we have a world where computing power is essentially becoming free, connectivity is ubiquitous, and everybody in their hand can have a very powerful device, which is more powerful than the computer in Apollo 11. So fundamentally, you have a huge tool for transformation, which is what I think we have. Now, even as these costs have gone down, the expenditure of the government, say, on social welfare has gone up. Today, if you look at India's spending on entitlements and subsidies, it is in excess of 300,000 crores, whereas if you go back and look at it, maybe even 15 years back, there would have been a fraction of this. So on the one hand, the expenditure we have on social services, entitlement, subsidies, healthcare, education, all these things is going up. And on the other side, the cost of technology is going down. You can plot these two things. And what it basically says is that if this is true, then with a small incremental cost, you can make a dramatic improvement in the effectiveness and productivity of whatever you do, because now technology is essentially becoming free, and therefore we are at this unique point. Now, if you accept this thesis that you have access to a global technology which is essentially very, very cheap, and it's only going to get cheaper and faster and better and more powerful. If you accept that this is a very competitive world where everybody is delivering solutions, a lot of it is open source, so you can get essentially software code from any open source vendor. The whole thing has made it very, very easy for countries to implement things. So given that we have rising needs and plummeting costs of technology, what are the kind of things that are possible? Let me tell you, what are the kind of problems that we can address? An example of a problem we can address is the problem of mobility. If you look at most people, they are mobile. They grew up in one city, they go to college in another city, they work in a third city. But many of the systems we have don't understand or don't acknowledge that mobility. In other words, our systems, the systems of governance, the systems of public delivery, have not been designed assuming that the resident is going to be moving around all the time. So if you go to a health center and have a checkup, the health record is there in that health center, but tomorrow you move to another city, the health record is back there in your old health center, you don't have access to the health record. Or you go to one hospital, you get some tests done, the test remains at the hospital, you go to another hospital, you don't have access. So fundamentally, our systems are not designed for mobility. Now, mobility is something that technology makes it very simple to do, because once you have the ability to keep your data on the cloud, and many of you probably do, then it doesn't matter where you are. So if I'm using my iPhone or I'm using my tablet or smartphone or whatever, I keep an account on Dropbox or G Drive or whatever it is, you know, Box, whichever, you know, I don't know which one you guys use, but something up there. And then wherever you're in the world, if I just want to download my thing, I just go to my Dropbox and download it. And therefore, the cloud and the fact that I'm ubiquitous means that I now have total mobility. So technology then, therefore, if done properly, can give us mobility, which is what we all want. The second challenge we have is how do we deliver large amount of change with less people, less qualified people? I mean, how do we deliver healthcare to everybody? How do we deliver education to everybody? Now, one argument is open more hospitals, open more colleges, have more doctors, have more nurses, have this, have that, all that stuff. That's one way to think of the problem. But you can't solve the problem that way, because your need for doctors or need for nurses or need for is just going to go through the roof. And none of them will want to go to villages anyway, so you know they all hang around in some hospital in the city, so they won't be where you want. However, if you use this new technology which has this cloud and mobiles and all that, you can have expertise sitting in a few locations and use the power of the network to amplify that expertise, so that if there's a high-quality teacher in Delhi, a kid in some village in Orissa can listen to his classes, or if there's a high-quality cardiologist in Bombay, then a kid in a village in Bihar can, you know, have his heart checked. So suddenly, you can now think of a hub and spoke model of delivery, where you have a few qualified people or a few pockets of expertise, and then you use the power of the network to reach out to everybody. So this is the second big thing we can do, and we can apply that to multiple fields. We can do that in healthcare, we can do that in education, we can do that in agricultural productivity, you can have agriculture experts on the net, and so on and so forth. So that's the second thing you can do. The third is, how do we universalize services? Now, one of the big things, if you look at how government programs work, is government programs spend a lot of time in identifying who are the beneficiaries. It's all about who are the beneficiaries. You know, so the whole debate is it the beneficiaries, you know, people above, below the poverty line? If so, how do you know all that? Now, how does the internet work? Internet companies don't, when you go and open an account, you know, on Facebook or Amazon, they don't really ask anything about you. They just let you open the account. However, once you are on the system, they have a very high quality of analytics and trust networks to catch the guys who are spamming the system. You get the point? So the way, when you think of internet companies or internet applications, low barrier of entry, but very good systems to eject the people who are not playing by the rules. The way we do entitlements, high barrier of entry, because you have to go through all these checks and balances before the guy comes in. But once he's in, you don't know anything about it. So what you can do with technology is you can flip this around and essentially make it, let everybody apply for everything. No problem. But if somebody is violating the rules, we'll catch him very quickly. And that's how we'll keep the system clean. So fundamentally, you can say, instead of having high entry barriers and no exit, have low entry barriers and smart exit. And that automatically will end. For example, you can have a rule that everybody is entitled to apply for the PDS. However, you please certify, self-certify. Nobody has to check. Self-certify that you are not an income taxpayer, you don't have a car, you don't have a house. And tomorrow, if you apply for the PDS, and then we find that you are an income taxpayer because you have the PAN number and you're paying taxes, or you have a car registered with RTO, or you have a house, then, you know, that's bad news because you're going to get penalized for that. So fundamentally, you can change the architecture of the way we deliver by removing barriers so that the really poor can come into the system very easily because they're the ones who face the exclusion problem. But you can also quickly use sophisticated technology to catch all the offenders so that you can make it very easy to make sure that the system remains honest. Then you can also think about one of the impacts of all this computing thing is what is called as the Internet of Things, which means that because this computer stuff becomes cheaper and cheaper, you just for a few paisa or a few rupees, you can get sensors, which you can attach to things. You can attach sensors to water pipes to see where the leak is. You can attach sensors to the sewerage system to see whether the thing is actually getting treated properly. Suddenly, you can build all kinds of smart infrastructure. You can build modern cities with smart infrastructure, which are actually exactly what is happening in various systems, because sensors have now become so simple, and everybody can have a sensor on these things. Or you can apply these sensors to, malnutrition. For example, if you look at the ICDS program, the fundamental measuring in the ICDS program is a child's health, child's height and weight. These are the two big factors. And the way it works now is somebody ostensibly, you know, studies it and writes it down. But suppose tomorrow you had a machine which had measures the height, measures the weight, and then through a Wi-Fi or a GPRS connection directly transmits that data into the database. Then automatically in real time you will have the nation's height and weight statistics for all children. Then you'll know, you can look at the patterns, you'll know where the malnutrition is happening, where it's working well. So you can change the whole paradigm of measurement by creating real-time systems. Or even in healthcare, you know, more and more today you are finding that instead of large, cumbersome equipment, you can use a mobile phone, and with a mobile phone and a few attachments, you can check your blood pressure, you can check diabetes, you can check this, you can check that. And suddenly you can deliver a new healthcare where the experts are on the cloud, but at the point of delivery, you have a simple device which will allow some
nurse or a local health professional to do all the kinds of checks, and you can use the power of the cloud to analyze and diagnose whether a person has a particular ailment. So suddenly you can change the whole paradigm using these sensors. So I think my point is that how do we, therefore, the reason why this is important in India in the context of my talk on industrial revolution, that unlike the first two industrial revolutions, India is a free country getting access to that technology in real time. It's in real time, right? You know, Apple launches some iPhone 4S and next day, you know, you're roaming around, some guy is flaunting his, you know, latest iPhone. So that's the way it is. So technology in real time. Technology that can be scaled up rapidly. Technology where related to the cost of now running a society is very, very cheap. And technology that is ubiquitous. Everybody is connected, everybody has a device, everybody is on the cloud. And therefore, in some sense, not having systems can now be used to leapfrog. Like if you take an example of the healthcare system, if you look at what's happening in US, you know, they're saying economic shutdown and all that. And fundamentally, the economic shutdown is that the Tea Party guys are basically saying that unless you reduce Obamacare, we'll not let you pass the budget or something like that. Now, why is Obamacare such a big thing? Because Obamacare is this huge project to give universal health care to everyone. It's spending billions of dollars. And inside that, Obamacare is a huge program to make every hospital, payer, provider, pharmacy, everyone use electronic health records and all that. Now, in India, we don't have electronic health records. It's a good news. So since we don't have it anyway, you might as well do it properly and do it in a futuristic manner. And therefore, using the technology we have, using this cloud, using the ID program, using the what we can do on the internet, we can build a very, very modern electronic health record system where everybody's records are kept, safely and securely on the cloud. And wherever you go, you just say, give me my health record. So you can be traveling, you can ask for your health record. And now because storage is cheap, every X-ray of yours, every ultrasound of yours, everything can be kept because it's very simple to keep all these things on that. So because you don't have a healthcare system, because you don't have vested interest in keeping it the way it is, which is what is happening elsewhere, you can actually build a leapfrogging system where you can build a brand new healthcare system which is dramatically improved from what it is in the West, but using the tools of the third industrial revolution to leapfrog. Similarly, we have yet to build our cities. I mean, the Western countries have already gone to 80-90% urbanization. We're only at 30%. So if from going from 30% urbanization, we're going to go to 60-70% in the next 100 years, we can build those cities in such smarter way that, because, you know, you're not build them yet, so might as well build them, you know, using all this stuff. Or, like what we're doing in the ID thing, we're building a next generation ID because we don't have any ID and we don't have the proper one, so might as well build a very modern one. So I think the way I see it, because I'm going to stop now, is that, as I said, the first industrial revolution hurt India. The telegraph, the railways, the steam engine, the Lancashire textile mills, all that affected us quite dramatically, made us go from being one of the leading countries of the 1820s to someone called a developing country by 1950. The second industrial revolution, we didn't really take advantage of because we're still under British rule. We didn't have urbanization. We didn't really leverage all these things like running water, plumbing, sanitation, electricity and all that. However, third revolution is here and now. And rather than, we have to look at it very differently. See, here's something which is up there. It's up for grabs. And taking advantage of the fact that we have many unsolved problems, is there a way to leapfrog and redesign the whole thing in a dramatically different way? So we got to jump over all these guys because their legacy systems are so complicated, very difficult for them to do it, but we can do it very quickly. And that's how we can take the full advantage of the third industrial revolution. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a fascinating and stimulating talk. I was very struck by the term leapfrog, and I was, of course, wondering, leapfrog has been used by a lot of political leaders, economists in the 20th century. One of the points you made very forcefully is that India can stand at the center of the third industrial revolution, and that this is easier because we're a latecomer. And one of the criticisms, which you hint at, I think, in your abstract, you write, some people have argued we should first wait for IR2 benefits before we adopt IR3 benefits. Would you like to expand on this? Is this the old debate between manufacturer and services? Is that what you're
saying? And services, but general thing, why should everybody have a mobile phone? Let's get the toilets in first kind of argument. So now, one is the toilet didn't happen. Second, it's relatively easier to get a mobile phone into everybody's hands in 5 years. And that mobile phone then becomes a tool of empowerment. That person has access to knowledge, the person can communicate, the person can get a job, the person can travel. And therefore, rather than saying, bemoaning that we don't have, let's get the toilets and then do the other stuff, might as well take full advantage of all this, bring it in, and use the power of this to improve the what we didn't have, like sanitation and health and education. So that's what I meant. That it's not the West did it linearly. First inception, second, it was linear. We do it non-linearly because our circumstances are different. That was my point.
Thank you. We can have questions. Please introduce yourself and then please ask whatever question you have. Yes.
Anisha Priyam, and I'm an ICSR fellow at the Nehru Museum Memorial and Library. I'm quite in agreement with your model where you basically say that the entry barrier is low and the exclusion rates will be brought down, and indeed our experience at Delhi government is exactly this. But it happened till a point, and the point till which the entry barriers were really low and therefore many people got recognized and into the system was till the point where the sovereign guarantees were working with the technology that was provided. But there was also a time when the factor or institution of intermediation raises its head up. So should your model then adequately factor in the human institution of intermediation, which is still an entry barrier, and perpetuates exclusion? And I think now the frustration is that much more higher because people have seen now that it's so easy to get in, but why are we excluded now? So would you want to somewhere along the way say that, my parallel computing needs to look at intermediation solidly as an institution rather than just say we will...
My view is that there are some things that should not need any intermediation at all, which is you do yourself. There's no reason why somebody can't apply for a ration card.